Hey, how you going, random stranger? Today we are finally going to be able to feast on some K-On! I feel a bit starved, to be honest, but the last week was just a tad bit crazy, and I'm sorry I didn't get to sit down and do a reaction. But in the meantime, it was awesome to get to read through all of your comments from the last reaction. First off, I gotta say, it's so cool to be watching with people who actually watched K-On! From way back, near or when it came out in 2009, 2010. I'm half jealous of you, also half grateful that I did find K-On! When I did, when all the episodes have already been released, because I can only imagine how excruciating it must have been to have to wait every single week for every episode. The fact that you're still here watching it in 2021 lets me know how much of a gem K-On! Really is. And I'd love to hear more about if it feels any different for you watching it almost a decade later, if it hits you differently, or if you just picked up something that you didn't before. But yeah, it's just great to have you guys along as well. Something else really cool from Masked Goose, I learned that there is like a broad genre of anime and manga called iyashikei, which roughly translates to a genre that heals hearts. And according to Wikipedia, it's any show that portrays characters living out peaceful lives in calming environments and is intended to have a healing effect on the audience. Which I think is totally a category that applies to K-On! And it's nice knowing that there's an actual word to describe what it was that I was trying to express last time, that K-On! Is just a show that makes you feel good inside. So thank you for that bit of info. I think the world needs more of this stuff, really. So motto iyashikei, please. Okay, moving on to a couple of notes on episodes 1 and 2. Something that Video Runaway picked up on. In episode 1, Sawaka Sensei says to the girls that a year flies by faster than you think. And they kind of just brush it off and keep talking about what they're gonna do that year. So on that video, Runaway wrote, "When you're young, you never really think about the passage of time." And I think it's such a good character moment, and also possibly a bit meta, as most fans do note that the episodes seem to go super quickly by the time they're over. Yeah, that was a good and that was an important pickup, because when I rewatched episode 1, during the scene where they sing the school anthem, they spend a fairly significant amount of time focusing on Yui and her passing by the cherry blossom trees, stopping and then picking up the petals that are falling down, and showing them to her friends. There's also when Yui is singing the anthem, you can see like a cherry blossom petal on her head. And I was thinking, why are they spending so much time on this? There has to be some deeper meaning there, KyoAni being who they are. So I googled cherry blossoms symbolism and voila. Basically, what is it? Where is it? Oh, here. Cherry blossoms are a symbolic flower of the spring, a time of renewal and the fleeting nature of life. After their beauty peaks around 2 weeks, the blossoms start to fall. Their short life reminds us of the overwhelming beauty, yet tragic brevity of life itself. So, yeah, there you go. The show is basically telling us, enjoy the show while it lasts, kids. And I guess, of course, the larger message, which I wholeheartedly endorse, which is that life is short, so make the most of it and learn and hone the art of appreciation. On episode 2, I feel like we hit another pretty major character development milestone because we discovered that our girls are entirely corruptible. I was shocked not only when Ritsu swallowed the receipt for Sawako's guitar, but more so because the other 4 girls in the back go full on berserk, just cheering her on. And the only thing that snaps them out of that is Sawako Sensei's like terrifying aura. The other thing, character-wise, that I couldn't really stop thinking about after the first 2 episodes, I really believe that of the 4 original girls, Ritsu is the most sane and grounded, which was a revelation to me. And I kind of want to prosecute my case for thinking this, by drawing like a sanity check diagram. So if you want to follow me, we are going to jump into K-On! Lecture 102, Character Sanity Check. Remember, if you want to brush up on K-On! Lecture 101, the crazy character web, you can do that in my reaction to Season 1, Episodes 9 and 10. Of course, if you just want to skip all of these nerdy ramblings and jump straight to the reaction, you can do that using the timestamps down below. But if not, then please step this way. So here we have it, my proposed K-On! Sanity check, or I mean, really it's like a sanity pyramid. You can see I've divided the girls into three different tiers of sanity, and I'll explain why in a sec. But this down here is like ground floor sanity. So this pretty much makes Asusa, let's please just be adults, Nyan, the sanest out of all the girls. Sorry, that is such a bad arrow. But yeah, basically the further up the pyramid you go, the more, let's not call it insane, let's just call it another type of sanity it gets. Yeah, I mean, I think the fact that Asusa is here, nearest to ground floor, is pretty much indisputable. That face of hers, let's zoom in. Yeah, that face of hers that she does whenever the other four befuddle her with their completely, well, less than conventional antics is pretty much a staple of the show at this point. So yeah, that is Asusa down there, pretty much carrying the sanity of the other four members on her back. And it's a tough job, but the other four girls more than compensate for it with their ridiculous amounts of love and affection for their kohai, as well as, you know, the purchase of pig-faced turtles, so that's fine. The really interesting part for me though are these two top tiers, with like Ritsu actually grounding the sanity of the other three. Hang on, let's just zoom in, see those better. Not too much. Okay. So yeah, my default had been, oh look, they're all adorably crazy in their own way, but no, actually Ritsu is in her own tier, closer to the sane side. And here's why I think that. So okay, let's just go through these three girls at the top. Yui is like Willy Wonka level sanity, you know, she lives and breathes and creates her own world, which I love. So things like, of course it makes total sense that Asusa should dress up in the pig costume, because you gotta complete the club sandwich, right? The club isn't a club if you don't have the bacon. Of course, seeing something as cute as a pig turtle, you'd want to put peanuts in its nose. And what else? Like, if you're in possession of a large wad of cash, you don't want to buy some high-powered amp with it. You just want someone to slap you with it, right? And I was tempted, given all of the above, plus many, many other signs, to put Yui, like, in a tier above here, all on her own, above Mio and Mugi. But then after considering, like, the brands of insanity of the two best girls, I think they're about even, given the nature and the extent of the crazy that these two can get to if triggered by the right thing. Okay, so what are these two triggered by? I mean, Mio goes off to fantasy land whenever she gets stressed or scared. Like in the last episode when the guitar shop owner tells them that Sawako-sensei's guitar is worth like 500,000 yen, and her brain breaks and she stutters out like, "Gochisou-sama," which is like, thank you for the meal, and then immediately goes crazy over the 5 million potential yen that they have in their hands. She also got freaked out in a horror movie type way when thinking about Asusa all alone when they leave and graduate. So Mio has insane powers of imagination that rival, I think, even that of Yui, and that's really saying something. Mugi, I love Mugi. The way that they've slowly built her character to the point where you just love her for obsessing over cheap homeware products and shiny tapware is quite impressive. I think Mugi's flavor of insanity is again very different to the others, because she's just in such a tiny, tiny, minuscule minority of people who have very little concept of what it's like to have to interact with the everyday economy, for one, where something as small as eating fast food at a fast food restaurant is mind-blowing, or the fact that she doesn't even give a second thought to how the tea set that they're using in a high school club is the same one that's being used by the Belgian royal family. But there's also a serious side to her eccentricity, in that she was likely brought up very much alone, socially isolated, the sole heir to a vast business empire, probably unable to experience all the normal social interactions that a regular kid would have, you know, with people constantly fawning over her and treating her with this distance, so much so that just being part of this club or this family and being surrounded with so much warmth and genuine friendship gives Mugi the freedom to sort of grow into her own person. That's so nice. Also, on a less serious note, her Yuri goggles, which I relate to a lot, that is a whole other aspect of her that puts her in this tier, I think. Okay, so the crux of my argument. Now, after watching episodes 1 and 2, it really struck me that whenever these three activate their god tier insanity levels, it's almost always Ritsu who is able to pull them back, or at least ground them. I mean, as you can see with these carefully selected examples here, so Yui being overly dramatic in her fall, Ritsu picks her right back up. Mio freaking out over that extra zero that's not even there, and Ritsu is like, you know, telling her to calm down. And then Mugi going absolutely ham in the Home Depot store, and Ritsu is like, why, what are you doing? So that's one thing. Ritsu is the ground here. The other thing is, whenever Ritsu herself comes up with an insane idea, it's almost always for a reason that is actually pretty sane. So when Ritsu blurted out that ridiculous lowball amount for Sawako-sensei's guitar, she was thinking about all the things they could buy with that extra money. Actually, a lot of the times it has to do with money. when she swallows the receipt, it's like her taking one for the team and trying, if not very successfully, to keep them from getting caught. Or like when she comes up with the idea of Operation Bug Catcher. So like trying to snag new members with butterfly nets. Maybe not the best of ways, but in the manner of a true mafia leader, she reasons that, you know, more members means more money in the club treasury. And also, you know, they have Azusa the baby to think about. So yeah, it really struck me that Ritsu has like this, how would you describe it? I guess this street smartness that I hadn't really picked up on before, but it was really obvious in the last 2 episodes. And it's that thing that kind of makes her the obvious pick for captain. And kind of she is the one that, when push comes to shove, like, she will go crazy. You know, with Yui, she'll do the dumb and dumber thing. With Mio, she'll actually kind of stoke her fears and fear of horror stories a lot. But when push comes to shove, and she has to put her foot down, she will. And I really love that about Ritsu and how she relates to the rest of the club. So there you have it, my thoughts on the Hogako Tea Time Sanity Scale. Again, I just love being able to think about how these girls relate to each other in so many different ways, and it really adds to the enjoyment of the show. And yeah, I'd love to hear if you guys have any further insights into this sanity check, or whether you'd put them in different tiers or whatnot. Just a few more last comments before we really are going to watch the episodes. So something cool on the opening song. A few of you did point this out, in the words of Tom Leete, that 360-degree camera spin in the season 2 OP is a total flex by Kewanee. That is wicked hard to do, and avoid looking at crap unless it's completely CG, and this isn't. Yeah, I was immediately caught up in that spinning motion of the camera, but I was not aware of just how difficult it is to pull that off in animation. And back in the day as well, using the tech that was available. So, I mean, man, more plus points for Kewanee again. I also want to add my 2 cents on the OP, but from a musical perspective. So this season's OP is more musically complex than the last season's. Not to say that it's better, it's just more complex. And part of why it's able to create this unstable, kind of chaotic atmosphere is just not just because the speed is a lot faster, but also because the snare drum comes in real hard on the offbeats. So what are offbeats? Like 95% of the music that you hear, the OP is in 4/4 time. So basically, it's like, you know, 1/2/3/4, 1/2/3/4, and that's 4/4 time. The pulses in between those beats are called offbeats. So like 1/2/3/4, and the N is the offbeat. And whenever the emphasis is placed on those offbeats, instead of the normal, you know, 1 or the 3, it makes the song almost like you can't really find your feet. Add to that this super quick, almost rap-like melodic line that is sung by Yui, and uses a lot of syncopation, which is just like another term to describe rhythm that stresses the offbeat or the weaker beats, and you get this sort of helter-skelter kind of feeling that is very in line with Yui's character, actually. So Renato Salzano had some cool things to say about the ending song. So it's more of a 60s influenced song visually and musically. There's also a bit of symbolism going on. It shows the meeting of young Mio with her adult self and how she is transitioning from one to the other. Notice how when she sings, she becomes a mix of the two. This fits perfectly with the underlying theme of the season. And yeah, again, just a great way for them to tie into the theme of growing up and of change. And finally, our final stop in this very, very, very long intro is the shipping corner. So thank you, Neptune, Helena Anjos, and Oliver Yayado for confirming that I'm not crazy to ship Mitsu. As Neptune pointed out, it's pretty inevitable. They're like yin and yang, and they also pointed out that in the ED, which I didn't notice, Mio's glove during the ED, she is wearing a black glove on her left hand, and Ritsu is actually wearing the matching pair but on her right hand. I also noticed that they're the only two wearing like off-shoulder shirts, and those shirts also mirror each other as well. So the inner shipper in me is like, yes. But also, interestingly, you know, conventional understanding of left-brained, right-brained people, which isn't exactly scientifically accurate, but it's widely believed that people who are right-brained, think Ritsu with the gloved right hand, are supposedly more creative, intuitive, free thinkers, while left-brained people, so Mio, think logically and are more analytical, detail-oriented and structured in their thoughts. And I thought that was just a very nice detailed touch. And the other really cool, like blink and you miss it kind of detail is future Mio actually wears like a black wristband on her right hand. So she switches from left to right. And that, well, to me, that proves that incontrovertibly that there is an important part for right-hand Mitsu to play in Mio's future. Yeah. You, oh my goodness. You know that meme when the dude is like, that's me right now. Anyway, okay, I think it's time we really get into the episodes now. All right, guys. if you managed to sit through that intro without skipping anything, bravo. But yeah, it's about time we went into episode 3. So if you guys are ready to do this, let's go in 3, 2, 1, play. So Caesar's studying. Takes a while for me to warm up to weird things. I can't help but feel like Tonchan is the animal spirit of Yui. Oh, she's looking at how to actually keep this turtle alive. What other exotic animals does Mugi's family have? Oh no. Okay, here we go. Okay, this is when the snare drums really go off on the offbeats. Yep. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and I'm not here. Okay, here. 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and 1 and 2 and 3 and 4 and you can hear that snare drum. It's right on the offbeats. I also love that heart that Yui does. Also, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. God, that is such good use of syncopation, man. She also makes some crazy interval jumps, so like the gap between notes on the scale. Here. Yeah, da 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 da. To be able to do that precisely at this speed is amazing. Ah, man, it's the more I listen to this OP, the more I really like it. It's like the songwriters got around a table and were like, okay, how do we write Yui's chaos into one song? And that was it. Don't say it. Oh. Just having a bit of identity crisis. They do need to get her like an elevated drummer stage. Sounds so fake. Oh, I like where this is going. Because you know how at the beginning they were all talking about how their instruments sort of reflect their personalities? Like, this is Ritsu gonna try every single different instrument, but in the end be like, no, the drums is actually who I am. Oh, Oh, it's so weird. Yeah, I agree with Mio. Kita's cheating on me. I hate it when I predict what they're gonna say next. I hate it. Senpai, sensei, you is so easy. Was gonna say, because Yui, she can't impart her natural talent to Ritsu. Ugh, that's. I mean, I know that you could, but that just sounds so complicated when you say it all out like that. She's a good teacher. She's gonna break guitar. Heya. Love how they handed back the guitar. Like they're handing over like a business card, you know, the Asian way. Oh, maybe she, okay, I'm not gonna say it. Whoa, that is a massive bento box. On her fantastical imagination, that's where all that energy goes. I love how they're exploring personalities through bento lunchboxes. Don't know who Cozy Powell is. Oh, this is Mio. You know, of course she would know Ritsu the most. Tamagoyaki. Oh, it's because she's become a homeroom teacher? Okay. I just don't see it. I just can't with these three. I cannot. I did wonder if it's Mugi that writes the songs Like, I kind of assumed it was meal, but maybe it's... Wow, how many scenes have we had of them just like doing the mutual cheek squeeze? That's her thing. Yeah, Ritsu can't take that away from her. That's the only instrument she won't touch is Mio's. That was real deep, man. Yeah, I was gonna say she's totally putting her soul into the bass and how it relates to the other girls. I love this. But yeah, to finish off that thought, maybe it's Mio and Mugi who kind of have a writing partnership. So Mugi writes the music and then Mio writes the lyrics. Is that how it works? Wait, so is Yui gonna try and take her with the drums? So Ritsu can take center stage? God, school photos were the worst. These other students, it's interesting that they're actually getting spoken lines this season. How much effort does it take her, I wonder, to hold that crazy rocker chick persona inside her? Yeah, it would be weird if Ritsu wasn't standing next to Neil. This is not gonna be what she expected. She got that from last episode's Home Depot store. I love when Yui, or she always goes over the top when she really cares about something, especially when it has to do with her friends. That's just who she is. Communication. Oh my goodness. I mean, A plus for effort, honestly. A plus plus. That line, when you hurt, we all hurt. Ugh, that's such a Yui line. I love her. Yeah, actually, what is the underlying issue with Ritsu? I mean, oh, called out. Okay, I think I read too much into that as well. Ah, she looks so cute in her non-school uniform outfit. With the, God, I forgot what these are called. Just mind blank. Having a bit of a relationship crisis with her drum set. It's sort of like, you know, in your marriage, you hit that 10-year wall. Oh, so cute. I love these flashbacks of these two. I love the way that she's done her hair instead of the headband. She's so happy. Ah, the who. Zahu. I do love that. Meal waited for Ritsu, even though, you know, they're running late. Yui. Huh? All those different hats on that statue. Back to her roots. Caesar's like, oh, mad. Ritsu. Mm. They become one. Oh, this show is gonna kill me. Everyone plays a critical part. Oh. We're not gonna get to hear this new song, are we? Oh, we are. Even when she just hums, I love it. These two, I don't know. Something's happening between those two. Yeah, so here we go. Our best girls are like the creative power behind this band. I love that. That just adds another element to the relationship they have between each other. Okay. All right, I'm not skipping this. In previous reactions, I've always skipped the ED for the first episode that I watch because I wasn't sure if people want to watch this twice. But yeah, so anyway, that's Future Mio with the black handband on her right wrist. I love the idea that that is the Mio that current Mio turns into. Obviously she comes out of her shell a lot more and becomes a lot more, you know, sassier. Okay, there's the glove, and yep, there's Ritsu with the other one. Yeah, so this song is like a lot more on beat. Okay, all right. Hey guys, on to episode 4, Field Trip. Okay, all right, if you guys are ready, let's play this in 3, 2, 1, go. Very strangely organized. Oh. I love that how they do the switcheroo with Yui and Ui sometimes. Okay, I'm gonna focus on the lyrics this time. Okay, it's all in Japanese. All right, it's okay. I can't understand this. It's not translated. They're so cute. Oh, they each get like a cute screenshot. I love how their hair just flies. Like there's wind blowing. Ugh, and Mio's hair flick. So good. Oh, the Shinkansen. Oh, so we don't get a Suzu this episode. How is she making tea on a train? So Mio took the photo. Whoa, what's happening? What's eating at meal? Oh, she misses the sane, grounded one. I do really feel for Mia though, because when you're the only super introvert in a group of really loud out there people, it is so tiring. What? Where are all the geishas? Oh, they're in Kyoto. Yui. I bet it's Yui. Don't know, she's there. Oh. I love how animes just take the opportunity to, be tourist ads in these super popular animes. Oh, it's very pretty. I love this background music. Like the traditional Japanese music. Let's see. Didn't take long. Mickey. He's got such a big brain. Oh, matcha tea. I don't really like matcha, but she's so cultured, it's scary. But to her, it's like, oh, you know, I thought everyone kind of knew this. And she doesn't really lord it over people. She just says it. I was gonna say. This show is really making me want to go to Japan someday. Cool. Guys. Just inappropriate. I love how Moogie, like, she's not the one that's like screaming and shouting, but she just very happily just kind of follows them along. Just ruining the mood, man. Oh. Dream college from Miggy. I wonder what our dream college is. What is she thinking? What was with the padding of the pillows? Ooh, looks so good. I love udon. Okay. So we get blessed with this scene. Eh? Oh, she wants a pillow fight? Oh, this is amazing. Again, just one of those sibling things, right? That she never would have gotten. This is a chance to live, you know? Live the normal life. Oh, Moogie. Oh my goodness, she's got an arm on her. She does eat, like, you know, consume a lot of energy. She only steps on Ritsu. She's happy though, despite her, you know, parent act. She loves that they're all like this. Sleep talking? We got a Mookie snot. I love how long they're spending on this scene. Just those moments at night when all the lights go out. That's just laughter. Ah, that was so good. Ah, okay. Mia's gonna like go in, she's gonna see something. Can't blame her though, it's hard being a left-handy. I mean, why not, right? They are so testing Mio's sanity. I wonder if we're gonna see a crack. Oh, wow. What is this music? Come on, McGee. Yeah. I'm so proud of her. I am inexplicably proud of her. You got a monkey's worth. I do love that even when Azinyan's not on screen, they kind of, you know, think about it. They get lost, aren't they? Without a Caesar, man, they're just completely at sea in more ways than one. Why, Ritsu? What? Because she's an old grandma? That's why you're speaking like that? That's so offensive. I don't know what she's thinking. Oh yeah, I'm just imagining a Caesar's face as soon as Yui said that. Even Noraka. Her voice is very soothing and calm, though. Is she breaking now? Did she just break? Milady. Oh man, that's so sweet. Stick with the one who can make you laugh like that. Here we go. Mickey's face. Oh. Protect, must protect. Oh. She's trying very hard to keep those lines clear. Okay, here we go. Some deep thoughts from Yui. It's always that music. It's always coming back to that the end is nigh theme. Oh, character development. There was a lot of the four of them just laughing because of each other this episode, and I loved it. Ah, K-On, K-On. Okay, I love that future Mio is sitting like in the layer of cake. And here we go. Okay, on the beat. I love that. When the cymbal, the tss, and she taps her feet on the cake. Perfect. So the bow goes into her head, and yeah, it's the mix of the future and the current Mio. Yui looks very cool. And the nice drums. Nice. Okay. All right, guys. Just some quick thoughts on episodes 3 and 4. To sum both of them up, they were really an indulgent exploration of, again, just the girls' relationships with each other. So episode 3 was very Ritsu specific, which I appreciated very much. Her reflecting on why it is that she wanted to become a drummer in the first place, and her realization that even though she's kind of tucked away in the background, that they all rely on her to, you know, count them in, keep them in time, to sort of be the glue of the band and give them that energy and the hype that they're known for, and really that they each have a part to play. So no one is more or less important than anyone else, and that when everyone plays to their strength, that is when the magic ensues. I also really liked Mio's short spiel on why she can't play any other instrument other than the bass guitar. The whole, you know, it allows her to stay in the background but also be an integral part of the team and play a more supportive role, which is entirely fitting with her more reserved character. And the way that they almost interchange their personalities with their instruments is really smart, and is just like another way, or another different way, to express how much these girls mean to each other. Also the fact that Ritsu totally respected Mio and understood like right away that she can't, unlike with Mugi or Yui, sort of take that away from Mio, that belonging on the bass guitar, even if it was just to try it out. And that empathy that springs from just a very deep understanding of who Mio is and how she reacts to different situations was so gratifying. So episode 4, the field trip, honestly, again, the moments I enjoyed the most were just when the girls were really enjoying each other's company and making each other laugh through the most seemingly mundane of things, like that extended scene at night when they're trying to fall asleep, and Mio, of course, is still doing the whole "come on guys, please behave" act, while the others are just bursting at the seams with laughter. And of course, you know that Mio can't ever last too long before she also succumbs to this, to just that pure joy of being part of this crazy group. I don't have too much to say about this episode right now, except that K-On is just so competent at taking you along for that emotional journey and making you really see clearly into the emotional bonds that are forming between these girls, all obviously building towards an end point where by the time you have to say goodbye, it's gonna be almost like breaking up with someone you've had a really long-term relationship with. So yeah, we have that to look forward to. Once again, thank you guys for taking this ride on the K-On! Train with me. Honestly, your comments and all the things I learned from them are amazing, and I'm really enjoying the show. So until next time, I do hope life is treating you well, and I'll try not to take so long to post up the next reaction. So I'll see you guys soon.